This is Riley Sheahan, number 15 of the Seattle Kraken, and I'm coming on the I Only Touch Greatness podcast.
Looking for the most beers on tap, great steaks, great staff? Head over to the John B. Pub.
We got the best beers, steaks, chicken wings, nachos in town. Come see us at the John B. Pub.
The John B. Pub, the best bar in town. Come sign up for our football pool. Say hey, St. You.
Turn it up. The number one sports podcast in Vancouver with Ryan Hayes and Big Mike.
Ryan Hayes and Big Mike are taking over the podcast scene in Vancouver. Get down or lay down.
Way more stressed, you know. It's just like on the ice, like things go so fast, and but you got to start somewhere.
You're obviously skating all summer though, right?
Yeah, but it doesn't equate. Like you skate all summer and that first day of camp just hits you different.
Yeah, you got the coaches screaming at you too.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay, and how was it? I mean, for opening camp for the Kraken here. Yeah.
No, it was unreal. Like the building was full, like because they let fans in to watch.
Oh, really?
On the one rink, yeah. Like, we used two sheets. The one rink, I don't know, can fit a little amount of people. But, yeah, the colors are so cool. Jerseys are badass. Like, it looks sick in there. So
that's what I was going to ask you that, too, what you thought of the jerseys. Because I really like them. I think the color scheme is great. And it's going to be nice to be competing against our Canucks, but.
Yeah, there's a lot that went into it. I mean, I listened to, like, I don't know if it was Adidas or something, the guy was talking about, like, the whole concept, like the S on your chest, like the Superman.
Yeah.
And then our little, like, sub logo, the anchor is, like, actually the space needle.
Yeah.
Just little stuff like that. Like, it's pretty cool.
Had you been to Seattle before?
Ever.
No. But what do you think now that you're in there? I love it personally.
I think it's great. I mean, obviously, like, few areas downtown, you got to kind of keep your head up, but
yeah,
but like I just love like the vibe, the creativity, like you get a lot of free thinking, a lot of like innovation, all this creativity, things like that. I think it's great.
Did you go up the Space Needle yet?
What's that?
Did you go up the Space Needle?
Oh no, I haven't yet. Uh-huh. I'm gonna have to start getting some of the touristy items checked off the list.
Oh yeah, in the gum wall, of course. There's a gum wall.
Seen the gum wall? Oh yeah, I've seen the gum wall.
Riley, thanks again for taking the time for us. So we'll get started here. Born in St. Catharines, can you tell us a little bit about childhood and when you started playing hockey?
Yeah, so I started about 4 years old or so, I'd say, and my parents are actually, they're pretty big basketball people. So my dad was a basketball coach in the area. My mom played university basketball. So I kind of grew up in the gym a bit, but just growing up in Canada, I think it's inevitable. You always give hockey a try, and if it works, it works. So, a lot of my youth was kind of split between basketball, hockey, and then I played lacrosse, soccer, a bunch of other sports. But then once I got to that age, at like 10th grade or so, I realized hockey was probably my go-to sport, and I just stuck with it.
Mike plays lacrosse as well, but he more just slugs it out there and runs up and down the floor slowly.
Yeah, it's a great sport. I mean, well, out in Van, right? You have Burnaby is a big. I remember our team, St. Catharines, the Athletics, that junior A team, always played Burnaby in the Minto Cup growing up watching that. So, it's a great sport. Yeah.
What do you want to accomplish this year? Being it obviously inaugural season with the Kraken, and any personal goals?
Yeah, I think just kind of the reason why we signed here is just the idea of a whole new team, kind of clean slate opportunity to maybe get in a lineup spot where I can kind of grow my game a bit. And I just think too, like the whole idea of playing with a new city is unbelievable. Playing with a whole new fan base was unbelievable. But I just think there's maybe some opportunity here for guys to step up. And I hope to be one of those guys.
Yeah, I think you're obviously on the team for sure. Like, it's not even a question. I'll be there definitely when you're coming up here to play Vancouver. You got a preseason game. I know there's one in Abbotsford, but there's also one at GM Place or Rogers Arena that I'll be at.
Yeah. I might create a little crosstown rivalry there, a little border rivalry.
Yeah.
It'll be good.
That's what we're hoping.
It will be good.
Yeah. We're hoping for that too. And then, honestly, we're waiting for this train to come in that they're built to build a train from Vancouver to Seattle that takes 45 minutes.
Oh, no way.
So, but I mean, it's a 10-year plan. They're talking about this 10 years down the road, which would be sweet for Seahawks games when I can rip down there 45 minutes each way.
For sure. Just for like, even just like new scenery too, right?
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
It's, I mean, something like, what is it? 2 hours?
Yeah, it's a 2-hour. It's about 2-hour drive from door to door to Safeco or CenturyLink Field.
Yeah. So just to have that quick trip to go check out new sporting event or just a new city, whatever. It's nice.
What we usually do is we go down like Friday. We catch. Now we can catch hockey. Is what the plan is. We want to catch a hockey game Friday. Catch the Huskies on Saturday night, and then you go and catch the course of Seahawks on the Sunday. Which
that'd be an ideal weekend. We got to go to the home opener, the Tennessee game. Okay, it was unbelievable. I mean, obviously, we came up short, but the game was great. The buzz was unreal. Like, it was pretty cool.
Yeah, we were supposed to be at it. So there's three of us that split two seats. So I get to go to every, I get the last choice, obviously. But so my friends, they're not letting, because the border's still closed, the Seahawks are returning refund money towards next season.
Oh, no way. That's awesome. Actually.
That's why there was so much open seats, because usually it's packed in there and it's so loud, just screaming the top of your lungs the whole time. I bet you saw that.
Yeah, we were definitely in the mix with some season ticket holders. You could tell they all knew each other, and it was really cool. We were kind of a little bit up from behind the Seahawks bench. And the Delta Club
seats.
Yeah. So yeah,
that's where we are too.
Yeah, it was a really good vibe down there. It was cool.
Yeah, it's awesome. Okay, Mike, you want to try this?
Sorry, I'm good now. I'm good. Who would you say you mirror your game after, try and play like when you were growing up, coming up the ranks?
Oh man, I'd say when I was in juniors, when I was a little more relied on to score and be an offensive threat, I loved Rick Nash. He was my guy that he was my guy that I really sort of idolized. Just like a big guy, power forward, good hands. I really loved Rick Nash. When I was a little younger, it was Peter Forsberg. I just really liked his game, kind of same reasons, just a workhorse out there. But then now as I get older, I still like try to pick and pull different things out of guys' games. And I mean, I'm more relied on as a defensive sort of PK kind of guy. I love Patrice Bergeron, the way he plays and his face-off abilities and just how dialed in he is in every part of his game. So you kind of just pick and pull things out of certain guys' games.
Okay. Mike, got shoot another one. I shot a couple in a row.
Yeah, sounds good. And do you have any pregame rituals or routines?
I'm pretty loose. I try not to be too superstitious. I mean, I do the same. I've been taking pregame naps ever since I got into the league and kind of just keep the same loose routine. I find if I get too superstitious, I get a little too in my own head.
Do you have any
Go ahead, Ray.
Okay. Do you have any hobbies outside of sports? What do you like to do?
Yeah, I love music. I'm a big, I play guitar and love to mess around with just listening to new bands and things like that. And
you're in the right city for that.
Yeah, exactly. We actually already been to one show at the Paramount Theater, which was really cool. We went and saw City in Color. I'm actually repping the shirt that I got from the show, but it was great. But see, yeah, there's so much kind of music history down here, and you can kind of tell like there's live shows aren't too hard to find.
Especially with Nirvana being from there, right? That's the big one. Soundgarden, I believe, as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you got like Macklemore too, obviously. Yeah. He's kind of a big face of the city. And
he was at the Seahawks game, right?
Yeah. Yeah. I think he's been kind of a little bit active with the Kraken gear and stuff like that too. So it's really cool to see.
Sweet. And probably the biggest day in your career, drafted 21st overall in 2010 to Detroit. Tell us about that draft day and stuff. And did you know Detroit was interested?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't know really where I was going. I knew first round was definitely a possibility. And it was amazing. I mean, I had my family there, and we got to spend some time out in LA and just enjoy the whole scene there. And then obviously when your name gets called, it kind of everything goes to be a blur. And I went up and get to shake Kenny Holland's hand, Jim Nill, and Mike Babcock. It was really cool. So it was kind of funny. We went up into a box after, and Babs is just so like, he's pretty intimidating. And going up there as a young kid, I go up there and I don't even think he looked at me when I walked in the room. He just went right up to my sister. My sister was a college rower at the time, and just sparked conversation with her and just talking about rowing and whatever else. And he kind of looked over at me and he's like, I don't need to get to know you for another 5 years or so. So he kind of put me in my spot to tell me that there's a lot more work to be done. I know getting drafted is a huge accomplishment, but there's a lot more to do after that. So
that's funny. And your first goal, obviously, against Jonathan Quick. Take us back to that one.
Yeah, that was a kind of a long time ago to think back, but it's such a special moment. I mean, I watch it sometimes now, and it's like I had Todd Bertuzzi there patting me on the head, and just some legends on that team. So I got to learn from a bunch of great players, and it was just a garbage goal, kind of getting my body to the front of the net. But it was pretty special at the time.
Yeah, Big Bert. Of course, we love him here in Vancouver.
Yeah, he's great. He's a beauty.
He is a beauty. He's got some good stories to tell. When we ran into him at an event out here last year or right before COVID, and he was great. He took time to take pictures with us and talk to us. And I always dress up and go to Canuck games dressed as Don Cherry. Like, I show up dressed as Don Cherry to Canuck games, and I showed up dressed to this. It was like a Canucks alumni event or some shit. And I showed up there, and then he's like, "Oh, you come here," drags me over there to take a picture with him because it was good.
No, he's a great guy.
Mike, shoot another one.
Yeah. What's your favorite road barn?
Oh, man. I always love going to Chicago. We live in Chicago in the summers, and my wife is from like the suburbs of Chicago, so there's kind of a little bit of meaning to those games. But I don't know. I just love, like, especially when I first came into the league, when they were really their powerhouse, and that gets rocking there. They play Ted Nugent, Stranglehold when they skate out on the ice.
Oh, yeah.
The rink's all red, and you get so fired up. So I think now, like, Chicago, Vegas is so fun to play in. Just a whole another like culture there, though, right? Like, it's just more of a party, and the fans get pretty rowdy. And those two are probably right up there.
I know that's got to be on our list of things to do there, Mike. We got to get down to Vegas to see a game.
I know.
I mean, yeah. First on the list is we're going to be going down to Seattle to see a game.
But absolutely.
If you could learn one new skill today, what would it be? It doesn't have to be in hockey. Any just life skill.
Oh, man. That's tough.
I know. I don't usually throw that question.
Like I said, I mean, I'm really big into music. I think it'd be pretty cool to be able to sing. Like confidently sing.
Fair enough.
I love the piano too. I just think anything in music, if I could really nail down something, be one of those.
If there's $1,000 prize on the line or a rookie initiation or something, and you had to sing a karaoke song, what song would you sing?
Oh, man. So I actually, my rookie party, we were in Vancouver, actually. I didn't tell anyone, and I surprised the guys, and I rapped "Give Me the Loot" by Biggie Smalls.
Yeah.
So that's kind of my karaoke go-to. If I'm going to put myself out there, I'll have a couple of drinks, and if I have to get up on stage, it's rapping that one. I think I
still know. That's awesome.
That. Yeah, awesome. I love Biggie. So the guys weren't expecting it either, so it was kind of funny.
Oh, so you're a Biggie over Tupac? Or?
Yeah. I mean, I still love Tupac, but Biggie's definitely my guy.
Yeah, see, okay. I'm the other way. I'm all Tupac, and then my dog's named Tupac and everything.
No way.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
I always grew up loving the West Coast rap, and then the East Coast. I mean, it's been 30 years. Like, we shouldn't have to still choose. Like,
yeah,
exactly.
No, I see you guys get some of the good old school rappers on your show. So I appreciate that.
Yeah. Because back in the day, I used to be like a mixtape DJ or stuff, and I was always into music as well, and promoting, doing shows out here in Vancouver. So I got a nice resume for music, and then when I retired from doing that and wanted to try something new, I want to interview all the old people that we worked with before, and plus new guys, not all these guys we ever worked with, but
no, it's great.
All the podcasts, it's been pretty interesting. We only just started. Well, on that note, I seen you guys, you started one, right?
Yeah, we just kind of, I just felt I had so much spare time on my hands, and I think just the mental health world is really interesting to me. And I've just had a little bit of a past dealing with certain issues. So we just decided to dive in and kind of get the mind working in a different way. Cause it's weird. You guys probably know. I mean, you guys, seems like you guys have been doing this for a little while, but
it's only been a year.
My first few episodes, I was like, holy shit, this is weird. Like, just trying to like almost, it's not like forcing conversations. Once you get going, it seems pretty easy or seamless. But to start, I was like, holy God, I don't know if I can keep going.
We go back and watch our first ones, and they're like, we almost are at the point where we're circling back to get the first few days. The first, because we do multiple episodes a day, but mostly like focused just on the weekend or Monday, Tuesday night kind of thing. But the, we're in the point where we're about to circle back on those first ones that we were
so drinking. Bad.
And we didn't have a good camera. We didn't have good mics. We drank just because we were scared, because it was our first one. It's like, so I'm shittered on all these opening episodes. And now it's like, okay, those were sloppy. Like, we need to go back and really adjust those, get those people back on.
Yeah. And
it's like, absolutely.
I got a lot of help with Tyler Smith. I don't know if you know Tyler, but he was one of the members of the Humble Broncos team who got in the bus accident. And he's unbelievable. Like, he's so good at just keeping things going, asking good questions. So I'm pumped that I got him. We kind of share the host role.
Good.
Oh, sweet, sweet.
And I see.
Go ahead, Ray.
I seen you just had JoJo Mason.
Yeah, he was a beauty. He's awesome.
Yeah, he was.
He's a super nice guy to meet in person too. Like he's an awesome guy. Just awesome, awesome guy.
Yeah, because we had him on here also, and then Mike, you've actually
hung met out him with a couple times. Yeah.
It just seems like so energetic and so easy to talk to. Like when we did the pod with him, it was almost like you forgot you were doing a podcast. It's just some good conversation.
Those are the ones that we always like, where you almost don't even have to look at your questions. You don't have any sheets to look at, and you just know, and it flows super easy.
Yeah.
It was kind of cool hearing from Chris Buck too, another country guy we had on, and he ends up messaging us yesterday because he's watching our AJ Galanti episode. I was like, oh, that's pretty cool that he's actually watching our stuff too. So.
Yeah, no, I saw that. How was that? Was that pretty? I just watched the doc. I don't know, maybe a week or two ago, but I thought it was
pretty cool.
Yeah,
it was pretty cool.
I mean, he's pretty good at it. If you reached out to him, he would probably jump on.
He
100% would. Yeah, he takes time for anyone that wants to give him time. But
yeah,
so. And we had the fighter on last night, Wingfield, and that was a good episode too. It was him and Ryan Holwig, and fuck, they were funny. They were funny.
Yeah, those are two heavies for sure. Probably got a lot of stories.
Yeah.
There
is some good ones. And turns out they're all from around here, so you can actually get together to have a beer. So
yeah, that's unreal.
If you were having a dream dinner party and you can invite three famous people, dead or alive, who are you inviting?
Oh man. I'd have to go, like I said, music. I'd have to go with one of even Elvis or a John Lennon. I think maybe Johnny Cash. I'd say Johnny Cash. And then maybe sports. You guys probably all like this one. Steve Nash. He's a Vancouver guy, right?
Yeah.
I'm big Steve Nash. I think he'd probably be my favorite athlete. My third one. I'd probably bring along my old man because I know he'd be pretty pumped to be there too and to be able to share that. That would be pretty cool.
Sweet. My three, I always go Tupac, Seth Rogen, would be funny. It would be great to have a conversation with him. And then either Hulk Hogan or some eye candy. I like to go with Shakira or Blake Lively.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I didn't even think about that. But yeah, now I might have to rethink my decision. Those are good ones.
I always roll with Muhammad Ali, the great one, Wayne Gretzky, and then I got to push Mike Fisher over and take Carrie Underwood at the table.
Yeah. All right. Fair enough.
Good stat of yours, scoring the final goal at the Joe Louis. Do you happen to have that puck still? Because that's a pretty cool stat.
I don't. They took the puck. They took my stick. And they just said it's going to the archives. I wasn't even in, I didn't even, right away. They just took it right when I got off the ice because – I think I was one of the stars of the night, and you take a signed wood stick and you put it over the glass to one of the fans.
Yeah, one of the cheap ones.
Yeah, our equipment guy just took my stick right away. He's like, this is going to the archives. I was like, I didn't even get a chance to say I want it. But
that's pretty cool, though. You obviously know it's somewhere now. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, no, it was a shit season. The whole year was shit for me. I didn't score until that game. So I think the hockey gods were helping me out a bit there.
Do you still have your first puck from your first NHL goal?
I do. Yeah. I have that one. I think I have the score sheet too, which is kind of cool. But yeah, I definitely have the puck too.
Okay. And do you have a favorite piece of sports memorabilia that you've ever collected, or do you collect anything?
I haven't. I definitely am going to start once I get we don't have a house. We're just living in an apartment in the summers.
Yeah.
But once I have space to put some stuff down there, I definitely will look to collect. I definitely want to get into some music memorabilia too, some signed guitars and records and
that. Sweet.
But yeah, no, nothing yet.
Okay.
Riley, what was it like winning the Calder Cup? Take us back to that.
Yeah, no, that was a blast. We had, for a first year pro with the team we had there, you just learned so much. We had so many good vets. Our captain, Jeff Hogan, was unreal for me. And then I just shared it. Like, you look at that team and there are so many guys that took the jump to the Red Wings the next year. And it was pretty cool to share that moment and then kind of have our first few years with the Red Wings together. So made a lot of good friends. And then, yeah, it was good. It was pretty intense. We played a good team in Syracuse. If you look at that team, they had a lot of guys that ended up playing for Tampa the next year as well. So it was a pretty cool series.
What's your first impressions of Jordan Eberle? I've been a huge fan of him my whole life.
No, that was just a beauty. He's just super nice guy. And then when you watch him out there, he's just so skilled. He's like so good and tight and on his skates, and he's got so much skill. So it'll be cool to watch him once we start playing. And like I said, just a good locker room guy too.
Yeah, he's got my number. He's got my number 14, and I can never get that world junior goal ever since that moment he scored that world junior goal to tie it off. That's beauty.
Do you know any of the other guys very well, Riley? Or are you thrown to all brand new teammates?
No, it's the one funny thing with an expansion draft, and I've played on five teams now or whatever. I'm good buddies with Jamie Oleksiak, Adam Larson I played with in Edmonton, so we're pretty close. I train with Connor Carrick, William Borgen, and I played in Buffalo last year with him. So yeah, I know a good handful of the guys, which kind of made coming here pretty easy when you have those relationships.
Absolutely.
And can you tell us a funny story about all your pit stops? Maybe a story from each one of your pit stops along the way.
Oh man, it's been too many now. I mean, Detroit was great because I get to play with like Zetterberg, Datsyuk. My first game was with Lidstrom, like Burt, Dan Cleary, Cronwell. We had so many legends. So going in there as a 20-year-old, I just literally just sat there and took it all in. I didn't really
soak it all in.
Yeah, you learn so much. And then we had Babs as a coach, and just the whole aura around the Red Wings was still kind of was there from when they were winning cups and everything. So I mean, I just learned so much and grateful for that opportunity, because it's so different now. Like, the league's so young now, you don't really get teams like that. To come into a team that's 35 years old, they're like 33 to 35, there's nothing like that anymore. So I just got to take that in. And then
Pitt was unreal. There?
Yeah, he was, but he wasn't playing. He was in player development.
And what about our other buddy, Jimmy Howard?
Jimmy was there. Jimmy's great, man. I love Jimmy. He was awesome. He's just such a nice guy, and kind of one of those legends, the tail end of that playoff streak and those cup runs. So yeah, he was awesome. But yeah, Pitt was great too. Like, going and get to play with Sid, I sat beside Sid in the locker room. So same thing, just get to learn so much. Like, this guy is the hardest worker, the most intense, but never like pushed it on anyone else. Was the greatest teammate. He'd stop when we'd leave the rink, he'd always be pulled up for the autograph seekers. I wanted to get their stuff signed. Like, there'd be a huge crowd. He'd always stop on the road. Same thing, just so down to earth. So those are the things I take most. I mean, the on ice stuff is one thing, but just being a good teammate, being a good guy it's priceless.
Yeah. That's crazy. And then it was one other stop, right? At least.
Got traded to Florida from Pittsburgh. That was just a little cup of coffee, a little 2 month spring break.
At the deadline, right?
Yeah. So I got there and we weren't in a playoff spot, but got to enjoy the sun, enjoy the beach. And yeah, my buddies.
Early vacation.
Yeah. My buddies came down and right away, it was right during spring break. So you go to the beach and it's flooded, like it's shoulder to shoulder with college kids. And it was just, that part was just wild to think that you're still playing in the NHL, but you have this outlet. It was pretty crazy. And then Edmonton, yeah, after that. And Edmonton was so good. Like, same thing as with Sid, like, you're playing with Connor and Leon. They're just so good, but just young, right? So it's just a different atmosphere. Definitely still some things to learn, but just kind of getting to feed off their energy was pretty cool.
And can you feel it when you come back to a Canadian team?
Like, oh yeah,
you can tell the difference, especially going from Florida right to Edmonton.
Yeah, no, they love hockey there. I mean, it's their thing, right? Like, the city, like, you have the Eskimos, and well, I don't even know what is it. You have the CFL team there.
Yeah,
yeah,
and then Elks. Yeah.
That's how they changed their name too.
Right. But yeah, hockey, like they're diehard. So that was really cool. And then COVID kind of put a damper in the season and we had to cancel and then go back to the bubble. It was just a really weird situation. So, but yeah, it's a great city. I love living there. Cold, but see the sun a lot and get to do all the outdoorsy things. So it's great.
What was your thoughts on the bubble?
I don't know. I mean, I understand they had to do it and I understand that you got to keep playing and fans want to see hockey and stuff, but I don't know, when you have however many grown men cooped up in a hotel room, it's tough. It wasn't
absolutely. That'd be so hard. No, that'd be tough. 100%.
But you almost got to give Tampa even more credit for pulling that off. Like that's just so much mental toughness and strength to stick together and play some good hockey.
Absolutely. Yeah. And what about Buffalo?
Buffalo is great, actually. Like as shitty as we were on the score sheet, and I mean, we had so many ups and downs with fire the coach, and we had a big COVID break where a bunch of guys got hit. We had the 17 losses in a row. Like it was tough, but there's such a good group in the locker room, and same thing, big group of young guys. And towards the end of the season, I was one of the older guys because we had a lot of injuries and stuff. So just getting to feed off their energy was awesome. And I grew up 45 minutes away from Buffalo, so I was in familiar territory. It sucked because the borders were closed. My family couldn't come or anything.
Oh, yeah.
But at least being able to play in the rink that I grew up going to games and streets that I were familiar with, that part of it was cool.
Yeah. But Buffalo is just one of those franchises. Jeez, they're like, actually they came in the same year as the Canucks and they've never won a championship just like us. So
same thing too. They love hockey there. Like I hope that they can figure it out. I think they will. Like they've got a lot of young guys, a lot of draft picks and things like that. So hopefully they put it together, but they just love their, you see the way they cheer for the Bills, right? And it's kind of similar for hockey. If they could
put their own people through tables.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. What number are you wearing with the Kraken this year?
15. I'm staying with 15. So
okay, right on. It was open. Right on.
Yeah.
So at the camp, then would that be only people that are going to the AHL, right? Probably like AHL or the NHL, but like Matty Berniers isn't going to be at camp, is he?
Yeah, we have a smaller camp too because we don't have an AHL team. So there are certain guys that are signed two-way NHL, AHL deals.
So
whatever happens. Yeah, they'll go. I think Charlotte is the team that we're affiliated with, but we only have a certain amount of roster spots on Charlotte to fill. So the rest of the group will be the team.
Okay.
So no, Beniers is going back to college. We already know that.
Yes, I know that. I mean, some of our other prospects we interview are at camps.
That's like rookie training camp going on right now.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I think the rookie training camps just ended. Yes.
Okay. Right.
Yesterday or maybe the day before or whatever, but yeah, now we're in full swing.
You got a favorite sports movie?
Oh, man. I'd like to say Remember the Titans was the first one that came to my head.
Okay.
But I feel like I'm missing some good ones. What do you got?
Rudy. And then probably Mighty Ducks, too.
Yeah, that's legendary for sure.
Yeah,
I was gonna say Slapshot. We still hear a lot of Slapshot quotes around the rink. So,
it's a
pretty legendary one.
We always hear Slapshot and Miracle from our young kids because they got to watch it on the bus at like 40 times a year.
Yeah, an undercover one too. Friday Night Lights. I love Friday Night Lights.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
Okay. Hey, Riley, I just want to thank you very much for taking the time for us today and coming on and chat with us. And we wish you best of luck this season with the crack. We can't wait to see you go out there and light it up this year. And we wish you best of luck this whole year.
You've got fans and us going forward your whole life. And we look forward to continuing, maybe having you on down the road. And you'll hear me banging on the glass at one of your warm-ups.
Yeah, I'll look for the guys dressed like Don Cherry.
And I don't know if I will be. I'm only doing it Halloween so far. We play the Oilers on Halloween night. So.
Okay. All right. Thanks, guys. This is great. I mean, I appreciate what you guys are doing. And like I said, the podcast game's tough, so I give you guys a lot of credit.
It is. I look at it like a crab bucket, and every person in town's got a podcast. Every guy in town's got a podcast, and it's like a crab bucket. People just. Everybody's trying to step all the way out of the bucket and get out of that bucket, and people stand on each other going along the way. And that's why it's good to make friends in the industry. And if you need anything, let us know. I mean, some of the contacts we have, we can easily introduce them to you. And I mean,
100%.
I'd love to get Jordan Eberle on, but
I'll drop it for him. If I can squeak it into a conversation, I will for sure.
Perfect.
Yeah, that'd be sweet. And one last thing, Riley. On our podcast, what we do is, this is all edited anyways, but we just do a drop. So could you just introduce yourself? So just name Seattle Kraken number 15, and you're coming on I Only Touch Greatness podcast.
Yeah, for sure. Just kind of shoot it. Just go right now. Mm-hmm. So name Seattle Kraken.
Yeah, number 14. Or number 15, sorry, 15.
Number 15. And then I'm coming on the I Only Touch Greatness.
Yeah, okay. Tell my name if you want to see it.
Oh, yeah, perfect. All right.
Looking for the most beers on tap? Great steaks, great staff? Head over to the John B. Pub.
We got the best beers, steaks, chicken wings, nachos in town. Come see us at the John B. Pub.
The John B. Pub, the best bar in town. Come sign up for our football pool. Say hey, sent you.